Good evening. I'm Moskov, Associate Dean for Research and Planning in the College of Science and Engineering. And I'm truly pleased to welcome you this evening for this very important lecture. Since its inception in 1935, the College of Science and Engineering has transformed the lives of generations of Minnesotans, kept our economy and innovation strong, and launched the careers of more than 65,000 alumni, scientists, engineers, and educators. The College of Science and Engineering's decades-long legacy of improving the health and the safety of the people of Minnesota and the economy of Minnesota and beyond includes inventions of the pacemaker, the retractable seat belt, and the black box. This is just to name a few of the earlier contributions. It has really fueled the significant impact on the development of sciences and engineering all over the world. This evening's speaker is Dean Samuel B. Mukasa. And Dean Mukasa, is this still working? Hopes to lead the CSE's outstanding faculty, staff, and students and alumni towards greater developments and transformational impacts on the lives and well-being of Minnesotans, people in the country, and of course, well beyond this land around the world. He assumed the deanship of the College of Science and Engineering in September of this past year. Sam, of course, is known as the dean. He's known as my boss around the College of Science and Engineering. But needless to say, he is a highly regarded scientist, and he has made major contributions in research in geochemistry, geochronology, and petrology. His work on the origin and evolution of rocks in the Bering Sea and the Arctic Ocean have helped shed new light on the evolution of the continents. And of course, this has major impact on the subject of this evening's lecture. Sam has many distinctions to his credit and many other accolades. He has had leadership positions at the National Science Foundation and the National Academy of Sciences on issues related to polar and climate issues. He is a fellow of the American Association for the Advancement of Science and the Geological Society of America. Dean Mukasa holds a PhD degree in geochemistry from the University of California at Santa Barbara, a master's degree in geology from the Ohio State University, and a bachelor's degree in geology from the University of New Hampshire. He completed a postdoctoral fellowship at Lamont Doherty of Earth Observatory at Columbia University. Dean Mukasa also has the distinction of receiving a Doctor of Science degree, honorary Doctor of Science degree, from Nkomba University in Entebbe, Uganda in 2008. Please join me in welcoming Dean Samuel B. Mukasa.
Thank you very much for that introduction, Moss. Delighted to see everyone. Thank you for being here instead of being at home in front of your television watching March Madness, or not. The reason I am here is that barely 30 minutes after it was publicly announced that I was going to be the next dean of the College of Science and Engineering at the University of Minnesota, I received a message from a faculty member in the college congratulating me, welcoming me to the Twin Cities, and then finishing off by saying, and by the way, I have penciled you in to give a talk 4 months from now, when you come to the Twin Cities in September. And I wrote back and I said, thank you very much for the invitation, but I think my ability to engage with you that Saturday morning is very much going to depend upon what is on my calendar at the time. I had no idea what my calendar was going to look like. He was not going to take no for an answer. Needless to say, 4 months later on a very early Saturday morning, I was on campus to give a talk very similar to this one that I had put together really for high school teachers for whom it is so vital that they understand these issues, and yet it is so confusing when you listen to the news and so on. I gave that talk, I think it lasted about an hour, and just as I finished giving it, Moscave, who just introduced me, said, you should give that talk at a public forum, and that happens to be tonight. Now, that conversation occurred in late September. It was before the election. I had absolutely no idea what I was getting myself into. So I will try to stick to the facts, not alternative facts, and I'm going to try and keep it to science and not politics. So here we go. First, I guess I have to turn this on, don't I? I'm a scientist, not an engineer. If you read the newspapers, you're going to unfortunately run into terms very similar to the ones I've listed here, summarized here. And these are coming out of pretty reputable publications, television networks, and even our beloved National Public Radio. They're using terms such as global warming skeptics, even coining the term climate gate. Climate change controversy, Glacier Gate, that's USA Today, and National Public Radio has even used terms such as he or she believes in climate or does not believe in climate. And I'm here to point out that climate science is not a belief system. You do not either believe it or do not believe it. Climate is controlled by parameters that obey physical laws, very much like a falling object obeys the laws of gravity, right? The law of gravity. And I dare anyone not to obey the law of gravity. And if you're going to be a denier, I dare you to, or an activist, I dare you to be a gravity activist. In fact, I don't even know what a gravity activist might look like. So these are very unfortunate terms, but you will find these in every newspaper, and you'll find them repeated on television everywhere. Now, climate does change. Okay, it goes without saying that a few short years ago to a geologist, 15,000 years ago to be exact, there was a very large ice sheet that covered much of Canada and covered much of the northern states of the USA. So 15,000 years ago, we couldn't possibly have been sitting in this auditorium because there was about a kilometer of ice right on top of this auditorium. That ice has disappeared since then. And it disappeared because climate changed, right? Climate did change. So climate, breaking news, climate changes. Now, it started to retreat, this ice sheet started to retreat back to northern Canada about 11,000 years ago. We can talk about how we know the timing and all of that, but that would add way too much time. We can discuss that later on. And the retreat began right around the time that humans crossed over from Siberia to Seward Peninsula right here in western Alaska. about 13,000 years ago, just as this ice sheet started retreating and going back to the Canadian Arctic, where remnants of it may still be found today. Now, those people who showed up first 13,000 years ago were not driving Chevys or Ford 150s or creating factories and that sort of thing, and yet climate was changing. What we can surmise from that is prior to any human activity that spews carbon dioxide and other gases into the atmosphere, climate was changing all by itself. The punchline there is that some of the climate change that occurs is absolutely natural. Okay, and I'm going to be showing you some reasons why that happens at various timescales. But I'm also going to point out that it is not a simple story where we can say, yes, you know, they're natural cycles, and therefore we don't have to worry about man-made pollutants and so on. I'm going to try and demonstrate in the time I have with you that both processes are taking place. There are some natural changes, and in addition, there are some man-made changes. I have been watching the Arctic region for many, many years now. So to orient you, this right here is Greenland. This is the Canadian Arctic archipelago. This is northern Canada. Here is Hudson Bay. And you can see that as recently as 1979, virtually all of the Arctic Ocean and the so-called Northwest Passage were completely covered by ice. But a few short years later, by 2005, you can see that an opening has arrived, particularly right along here, along the Siberian coast. And also you're beginning to see some open waters in the Northwest Passage. You know, people died in the 19th century trying to find their way through this area for a shortcut from Europe to end up in Asia over here, if only they had waited about 100 years. Because now it's open waters, as I'm going to show you. This is an animation that takes data from 1979 to 2012, and you can see that this ice over the Arctic started out covering the entire ocean, but now it has receded. This is summer ice, by the way. It has receded way over here, completely open waters, and also the Northwest Passage clears up completely during the summer. Okay, that's very new development. It's not something we had seen before until the last couple of decades. Now, Mark Twain is reputed to have said that there are lies, dumb lies, and then statistics, except he didn't say it. And when he did say it, he attributed it to the person who said it first, and that would have been Benjamin Disraeli, who was Prime Minister of the UK back in the 1800s. But everybody says Mark Twain said this. And what I mean by lies, dumb lies, and statistics is that although I haven't quite seen this headline, I imagined it this afternoon when I wrote this, Arctic ice declines alarmingly this summer is a headline that you're likely to see in a newspaper, no doubt. Okay, that would be focusing on the fact that from this period, whatever that year that was, to there was a major drop in the amount of ice available over the Arctic Ocean. But after you read that headline, again, I had high school teachers in mind as I was writing this. After you read that headline, another one shows up. Arctic ice recovered this past winter. It grew back, so we don't have a problem, right, is what you would be reading. Whereas actually, what really matters a great deal in this diagram is the observation that integrated over several decades from 1978-79 to 2016, there is a significant drop in the aerial cover of the ice over the Arctic Ocean. Now, this happens to be the ice extent in February, which is the middle of winter in the Arctic. So those of you who are thinking ahead, you would say, well, okay, let's look at the scale here, extent in million square kilometers, 16, 15, and so on. On the next diagram, which is taken at the end of summer in September, you can see that the aerial extent is much, much smaller compared to middle of winter. And in fact, the demise of this ice is taking place at a rate of about 12% per decade. And the speculation, if you keep drawing this line all the way up to way over here, is that by around 2030, which is just a few short years away, we're not likely to have any summer ice in the Arctic Ocean. Now, that's a frightening prospect, but I don't have the time to go into why that is really frightening. But you know, water absorbs heat and so on. Right now, we are using this ice in the Arctic region as our refrigeration system that deflects a great deal of solar energy back into space. When that ice is no longer there, every ray of sunshine that comes to the surface in the Arctic region is going to be absorbed by that water, and that has consequences. That absolutely will have consequences that are frightening. Among the consequences, now we are moving away from the ocean to land, is looking at Greenland. There's been an ice sheet on top of Greenland for many, many millennia, but this was in 2012. You are forming rivers as this ice begins to melt away in very, very large volumes. And one of the things that is very disturbing is this water, wedges, it freezes at night and then wedges the crack even deeper so that the water keeps going further and further down and eventually gets to the base of this ice sheet and lubricates the surface, which then promotes the much larger pieces of ice to actually start moving as well. So you may think that this is just a surface problem, but actually it becomes a very serious problem when this water makes its way to the base of the glacier or the ice sheet and speeds up its demise. Now, when all of Greenland melts away, how much is sea level going to rise? Do we know? If all of Greenland melts away, all the ice on Greenland melts away, how much is it going to impact sea level? Yeah, it's going to be roughly 20 to 25 feet. Yeah? If you've been to South Florida and you have a little tape measure to see where 25 feet is, don't buy real estate there. Right. And looking at other places very quickly, this is Muir Glacier in Alaska, a photograph taken in 1941 from a particular vantage point, and a photo taken in 2004, so that's about 65 years later, from the same vantage point, and you can see that the fjord is completely open water now. And in South America, in the country of Peru, the Calcaya ice cap, a picture taken in 1978, and about 24 years later, you can see that it has retreated by a couple of kilometers. So these changes are real, and they are manifestations of a changing climate. Really, the honest question for us to be asking is whether the observations being made here are due to natural cycles, very much like that Laurentide ice sheet retreating away from Minneapolis 15,000 years ago, or whether this is something that is related to more recent developments in atmospheric chemistry. That's really where the scientific questions to be answered happen to be. Now, this happens to be my favorite volcano. I figured I would show you some examples from the tropics as well. This is Kilimanjaro in a photograph taken in 1912 when snow and ice came all the way down to about 16,000 feet. This is a volcano that's about 20,000 feet high. So there was snow and ice covering the top 4,000 feet or so. So that's about 4,000 feet from 16,000 to about 20,000 feet. And that's me at the age of 15, near the peak of Mount Kilimanjaro. And I can tell you that even at the age of 15, I can remember very distinctly that there were massive glaciers at the top of this volcano. It's just a few kilometers away from the equator. And if you look at this volcano over the last 10 years or so, this is a picture taken in the year 2000, so that was about 17 years ago, you can see that snow and ice used to come to about this level. The breaking slope right here is how far it used to come. But most of it has disappeared. And 6 years later, much of it is gone. And there is a very long story I don't have time to tell you about what is going to happen to the wildlife at the base of the mountain, which use water supplies that are related to the glaciers over here melting every year. But unfortunately, the glaciers are pretty much gone, and the speculation is that in another year or so, there probably won't be anything left on this volcano at all. So the migration of animals from the Serengeti to Amboseli that happens yearly, that these animals learned over thousands of years, is about to come to an end. In fact, I tell all of my friends who are interested in African wildlife that if you really want to see it, go now. Because if you want to go 5 years or 10 years from now, chances are they won't be there. One of the consequences of recent changes that we've observed. Now, when you combine the observations we've made at sea and the observations we've made on land, you end up with what I call 10 indicators of a warming world. These include an increase in humidity. And when the humidity goes up, obviously, there's likely to be more snow falling. So people always ask the question, if humidity is encouraging clouds to form and therefore you're going to form more ice, why is it then that the ice over the Arctic Ocean is melting away or is the volume is becoming much, much smaller, and also the aerial extent is becoming much, much smaller? Well, the reason is, in spite of perhaps increased snowfall, the ocean is much, much warmer, so that these ice sheet, or rather the sea ice, is actually being eroded by having its bottoms melted away, is the problem. That's why it's disappearing. But every other indicator that you can look at is showing that climate is indeed changing. Now, some people are in denial. They're saying, okay, you are describing something that's happening in the Arctic. What does that have to do with Minnesota? You know, Karen Crouch and I were just talking about the winter that just passed. Maybe it hasn't passed yet, right? We may still get another foot of snow. But we were just talking about the fact that I'm very thankful that you know, the weather decided to ease me into Minnesota a little bit. We didn't have those massive snowstorms and temperatures below zero for weeks on end. So I'm cheering for climate change. Or not. So integrated over the entire planet, this is an image that NASA has produced by comparing what the surface temperatures are as of June of 2016, compared to the average between 1951 and 1980. And you can see that by 2016, just about every place on the planet, with the exception of perhaps southern Brazil, northern Argentina, and the Antarctic over here, just about every place else is showing that there has been significant warming. Now, the question is, and this is where high school teachers are always very eager to, you know, learn the mechanics of this, is how does it happen, or why is it happening? And the answer is that there are processes occurring naturally over very, very different time scales. So I'm going to show you that part of why climate changes is related to the fact that land masses, the continents themselves, are moving. They are moving only a couple of centimeters per year, but when you integrate that over a period of several million years, it really reconfigures where the land masses are, you know, relative to the surface of the planet, and that has consequences to climate. And I'm going to give you a couple of examples. And on the much shorter time scale, tens of thousands of years, there are some changes in the way that our planet interacts with all the other planets in the solar system that changes this, you know, we're told in middle school that the Earth goes around the sun in a circular orbit. That's true part of some of the time. It is not true all of the time. Okay, the interaction of our planet with the rest of the other planets in the solar system every now and then is going to change the shape of that orbit of our planet around the sun, and that has consequences to climate as well. Okay, and then at the very end, I'll show you that fluctuations in carbon dioxide particularly, and also they're still very difficult to explain reasons why certain regions of the ocean will become warm all of a sudden and create havoc to ocean circulation and all that, that we call El Nino, these are going to impact climate on a decadal scale. You know, so very, very rapid climate change. And the take-home message from what I'm saying today is that both of these processes, long-term and short-term, are taking place. And we do have measurements we can make to try and decipher which effect is from long-term processes versus short-term. Okay, so speaking about long-term, let me give you this example of the fact that 40 million years ago, South America and Antarctica were actually joined by this land bridge, not atypical, rather not dissimilar from the Panama land bridge that connects South America to North America. But over the last 30 million years or so, this landmass has split so that Antarctica is now decoupled from South America by the opening of the Drake Passage, and that created a very strong current known as the Antarctic Circumpolar Current that isolated the continent and made it glaciated. So this is a climate change that occurred about 34 million years ago related to land masses reconfiguring themselves. It had tremendous consequences for the rest of the planet because this glacial ice, or the ice sheet over Antarctica, acts as a refrigerator for the rest of the planet, not just Antarctica, but for the rest of the planet. If that ice were to disappear, these people and those people and those people will definitely know about it because their climate is going to be different. Things are going to be much, much warmer. So this refrigeration system serves our people on all of the continents. Now, that was land masses. Now let's look at what happens when our planet interacts with all the other planets around it. Now, we all know that the planets are in one plane, the plane of the ecliptic, except for that weird Pluto. No wonder it was demoted. It's no longer considered a planet. All the other planets are in the same plane, and they all go around the sun in that same plane. And they are located in different locations at any one time. But on a periodicity of about every 100,000 years, they all line up behind the Earth. And when they do, their gravitational pull kind of yanks our chain, and we go from that circular orbit that our middle school teachers told us about. It's no longer circular. It becomes a little bit oval. And when it does, we are not receiving as much sunshine, as much solar energy on the surface of the Earth as we do when we have a circular orbit like this. So we go from one extreme end member like this, which is circular. This is what we were told in middle school. But every 100,000 years, we actually look more like this. When we're way out here, being at the beach is not so much fun. Or when we're way out here, being at the beach is not so much fun. The periodicity of this is 100,000 years. So in addition to our orbit around the sun being interruptible, the Earth, as you know, rotates on an axis which is not perpendicular to the plane of the ecliptic, that plane where all the planets are moving around the sun. It is inclined by 23.5 degrees. Now, that happens to be right this instant, right? If you stayed around here several thousand years, you would observe that actually the Earth rocks back and forth on that axis as illustrated here. And that rocking back and forth takes us to extremes of about 22 degrees when we are almost vertical, but then we go inclined to almost 24.5 degrees over here. We happen to be right in the middle, which is rather curious, right? Between those two extremes. And the back and forth of rocking along the rotational axis of the Earth is known as the obliquity cycle, and that happens on a periodicity of about 41,000 years. And then the last orbital forcing I should share with you is the one that is a little bit more difficult to explain, but it's called the precession of the equinoxes. So in addition to all the other planets yanking our chain every 100,000 years and us rocking on our axis like this, we are almost like one of those spinning tops that is about to fall and it starts to gyrate like that. So we are tracing out the axis, the rotational axis of the Earth, this one here, is actually tracing out a path in space that is circular like this. So it's actually wobbling. We are wobbling like that, and that wobble has consequences. The periodicity of that wobble is roughly 20,000 years. That also is going to impact climate. Okay, so those are the long-term effects or factors that are going to control why climate changes. Superimposed on all of that is something that you and I might be responsible for. And I show you here a record of measurements. This is measuring concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere in parts per million, since the 1950s to today over here. And you can see this unmistakable climb that now has us, as of yesterday, at 406.3 parts per million. And a few short years ago, 5 years ago, we hadn't yet quite reached 400 parts per million. And if you go back to way back into the 50s and so on, we were roughly 300. So we are going up fairly rapidly. And as the rest of the world becomes industrialized and more affluent and more people buy cars and use electricity and so on, you can see that this is going to speed up. Yep. So that's likely to speed up. Now, the problem is that that carbon dioxide that we are putting into the sky is making a layer that I'll park right about there, which behaves very much like a one-way mirror. A one-way mirror is going to allow light to go through in one direction, but it's not going to allow light to go through in the other direction. So the solar energy coming out of the sun is able to penetrate through and come to the surface of the Earth, but when we have these pollutants in the upper atmosphere like this, they prevent that energy from radiating out to outer space. This is what every fourth and fifth and sixth grader will recognize as the greenhouse greenhouse effect. And here I have drawn a picture of a greenhouse to show that when energy leaves the sun, comes from the sun and reaches the surface, it comes in one form. When it reaches the surface, it's transformed and develops very different characteristics. When it's leaving the sun, it comes in as ultraviolet radiation, which, as you can see, has a very short wavelength, a very high frequency. So you can call this the skinny wave. It's able to penetrate through that pollutant material in the atmosphere. So it's admitted to the surface. When it gets to the surface, the energy is converted to infrared radiation. That's why I'm using the red color. And that infrared radiation, as you can see, has very different characteristics relative to this very short wavelength ultraviolet radiation. This long wave radiation, infrared, is not easily expelled through this lid we've put on top of the atmosphere. So that energy is going to stay very close to the surface, and that's why it's the greenhouse effect. That's why we are warming up. Now, our new director of the EPA, Mr. Scott Pruitt, wants us to tell school children that this doesn't happen, that energy coming in and being prevented from escaping by the greenhouse effect actually does not happen. So putting CO2 in the atmosphere apparently doesn't matter. But I think every fifth grader and sixth grader who has run the experiment will tell you that it does matter. It does matter. Mr. Pruitt needs to go back and talk to fifth graders. They'll show him what happens. Yeah. Now, in this part of the talk, what I'm going to do is to try and differentiate between those long-term cycles I just talked about, land mass is moving, and orbital parameters, where our planet is relative to all the other planets in the solar system, and then the carbon dioxide that we're putting in the sky. How do we differentiate between those, the long term versus the very short term? And for that, what I'm going to show you is we do have snowflakes falling. And if you've ever walked into snow that has accumulated on the ground, if we have a foot of snow, which doesn't happen in Minnesota anymore, I understand. But if you had a foot of snow and you walked through it, you would notice that you sink. And the reason you're sinking is because the snowflakes are separated from each other by air. The air that is trapped between them is representing whatever atmospheric composition is on that day that we had a snowstorm. And then if you were to be in a very cold climate like Antarctica, and that snow fell and it didn't melt, and the following snowstorm piled on, and you did that for thousands of years, you're going to pile up a huge amount of snow, which of course eventually coalesces into ice. And what started out as connected pockets of air will eventually become isolated from each other and form these gas pockets trapped within the ice. Now imagine doing this for hundreds of thousands of years, so that you pile up enough snow and ice to form an ice sheet that happens to be on the order of 2 or 3 kilometers thick. And each one of those layers, as it fell, trapped whatever the composition of the atmosphere was at that particular time. We have technology that allows us to sample this entire section of the ice, all 2 or 3 kilometers of it, and we know from the layering what the atmospheric composition was at a particular time. When we recover the ice, it looks something like this, and you can note the very faint layers which represent annual snowfalls. You know, there's a little bit of abrasion and recrystallization so that it marks where the snow snowfall ended in a particular year before you pile on another. So it's very, very distinctive. In fact, it's very similar to counting tree rings, where each one of these rings represents a season of growth, so that if you wanted to know how old this tree was when it was cut down, all you have to do is to count all of these rings. So we do the same thing with ice in ice sheets, and we calibrate ourselves by finding some key markers when there was, say, for example, a volcanic eruption that spewed out some ash that has potassium in it, and I can date the potassium decaying to argon to find out exactly where we are within that sequence. And when you look at these gas bubbles that are trapped between the ice crystals, here magnified thousands of times, they look something like this. So I can melt this ice and recover the gas that came out and measure the concentration of carbon dioxide and tell you exactly what the concentration of carbon dioxide was, let's say, 100,000 years ago, or even 500,000 years ago, or even close to 1 million years ago. Okay? And this exercise we've done in Antarctica to come up with little wiggles that look like this. And I'm going to talk about just two of them and ignore the rest of them. We are definitely interested in carbon dioxide over here. And what it shows is that going back to about 700,000 years ago, so this is before you and I started driving Chevys and Ford 150s, right? Way over here. Coming to today, today is over here, you can see that for carbon dioxide, it started out below 200 parts per million, goes up, comes down, goes up, comes down, and repeats this rather regularly related to, we think, to the orbital forcing of climate change. That, again, those planets are aligning themselves every 100,000 years and so on. They are yanking on our chain. And the reason it's not such a tidy series of fluctuations here is, in addition to that 100-year eccentricity cycle, superimposed on that is this rocking back and forth and also the spinning around the axis like this. All of those contribute to the complexity of the fluctuations that you see here. What is most interesting about this is that over the last 1 million years or so, we've seen those fluctuations within limits to about 260 or thereabouts parts per million. What's frightening is that. Okay, so over the last few decades, as I pointed out, we've seen carbon dioxide go from these levels here, which mimic what was happening with natural cycling of previous millennia, and this time around we didn't go down, we've actually just kept going up. This is what I would call the anthropogenic signal. This is what you and I are likely to be responsible for. Now, if you've read the newspapers or books, you will also have noticed that this wiggle right here representing methane, you know, thankfully still in very low concentrations, parts per billion, the average, the fluctuations you see right here, going back in time to almost 1 million years, those fluctuations reached maximum values of about 720, 730. But similar to carbon dioxide, that is also pretty scary because last time we had a maximum of about 730 or thereabouts, instead of continuing to go down, we've actually continued to go up. And that now is 1,800 parts per billion. Methane is a much worse greenhouse gas than carbon dioxide is, so that this is something to be very concerned about. And that signal there is also what we might call the anthropogenic signal. This is something that we think is because of human activities. Now, as I reach the end of the talk, it's quite interesting to always talk about what happens to sea ice, rather to ice sheet volumes. 15,000 years ago, when we had a lot of ice even here in the Twin Cities, naturally sea levels had to be much lower since all of the water, well, much of the water had been taken out and gone into the ice sheets on land. Florida used to be much bigger, okay, as you can see here. Today, Florida's outlines are like so, but 15,000 years ago, it was actually more like this, and places like New Orleans didn't have to worry about Hurricane Katrina because they were inland, a fair distance away. The Laurentide ice sheet melted away so that all of this area was drowned. And if we fast forward it into the future and Greenland melted away, I had people in the front already tell me that that's going to raise sea level by about perhaps 20 feet, right? And of course, as the warming occurs, the water volume is going to increase. It's like having a pot of water that's full to the brim. If you heat it up, it's going to spill over because the volume increased. So if Greenland melted, we would have about 20 feet of sea level rise. Miami would be underwater. Places like New Orleans and Jacksonville would also be underwater. And then if we melted away Greenland plus the East Antarctic ice sheet, Florida would be completely gone. I think there are a couple places in northern Florida right about here that would be nice islands with, nice properties there in the middle of the ocean. Okay, the rest of the world would be impacted as such. Again, here is our Gulf Coast. A lot of it would be underwater. But much of Western Europe actually would be completely gone. Bangladesh would be completely gone. The Central Australia would be gone as well. And coastal cities, New York City, Tokyo, Singapore, places like that, which today may look something like this, might actually become isolated buildings in the middle of the ocean. Okay, so this is something to definitely be concerned about, although indeed it's not going to happen in just a couple of years. Now, there are a bunch of islands in the Pacific which are barely above sea level. And this poor young lady, as you can see, has a home. You can see the palm trees over here, so the ocean is just over there. And you can see that the ocean is coming. And yet we don't like refugees too much. But chances are, this young lady and the rest of people who live on this particular island in the middle of the Pacific are going to become climate change refugees. So I'm hoping that the rest of the world is going to have the compassion to help people like her, because she didn't really cause that problem. I think you and I did. So as we try to keep people out, I hope that some exceptions are made in situations like this young lady here. Little islands like the Maldives in the middle of the Indian Ocean, they are barely above sea level, fantastic island, lots of snorkeling here, but this is a country on borrowed time because unless they build massive walls around this island, they're definitely going to be underwater. So one might ask the question, has this happened before? And the answer is yes, many, many times. This is looking at time over here from 300 million years ago to today. And this is particularly for the continent of Antarctica, which, as you could see in my previous diagrams, has 3 kilometers of ice on top of it. But when we go back in time, such as about 250 million years ago, there was a forest there. And then when we look at deposits from about 200 million years ago, we see ferns like so. And closer to today, roughly 30, 40 million years ago, you see remnants of wood. This looks like it could even burn today. There was a forest there, but this is a continent that today has 3 kilometers on top of on top of it today. Okay, so climate has changed numerous times throughout Earth's history, and the obvious statement to make here is that many of those fluctuations have been natural, but the very latest one that we're seeing today is very, very different from all of the previous ones, and that's what we call anthropogenic. Closer to home, this is in the state of Wyoming, and if you go back to deposits from 50 million years ago, you'll note that in Wyoming they had cycads, they had crocodiles, they had a pretty tropical-looking vegetation. So Wyoming, not that long ago, was much warmer than it is today. Now, this is a diagram, and I could finish here in order to save a little bit of time for discussion. This is a diagram that shows us what is likely to. It's based on modeling. Okay, so this is based on modeling. These are measurements. Since we are right about here, we have measured the fluctuations in temperature since about 1900, and this is what we are observing. And I just pointed out that with global population going up and affluence going up and so on, we're going to be putting out more CO2 more quickly, that if we don't try to reverse that, this is the trajectory we are going to be on. And the Paris Accords of a couple summers ago attempted to cap our emissions so that by 2050, we will be close to the maximum values of CO2 we are going to put out so that we don't go any higher than a 2-degree increase in the future. Our president, our current government, has pointed out we may scrap all of that. And if we do, this is business as usual. If we don't do anything, by this time in the future, about 2100, we're going to be upwards of 3 degrees warmer than it is today. Now, this may not sound like very much. It's frightening. It really is frightening, because if you have a 3-degree change in average temperature on the surface of the Earth, the oceans are going to store a lot more energy than they have today. That means bigger storms. It means all the critters in the oceans that prefer a particular temperature range are likely not to survive. Now, I like fish. I don't know about you. If they're all gone and we are all trying to eat beef because there are no fish left, and the beef industry is one of the worst polluters in terms of methane, you know we are digging ourselves a big hole. We're going to have a tough time to come out from. So I am hoping that we will continue the discussion as global citizens, because this is not a trivial problem to confront going forward. Now, I was going to cover a few exercises that various nations are undertaking in order to mitigate this problem, but we don't have that time. So let me just finish off by asking the question, what can we do as global citizens? The first one is advising you not to buy any property close to the ocean. You know, I've seen houses in South Florida that are on stilts. As I said, there are chances that these are going to go before you do. So I wouldn't do that at all. Conserving resources becomes really, really important. You know, it has been said that here in the U.S. we are about 4% of the global population, but we use 25% of its energy. That is not sustainable long term, and Europeans have pointed out to us that their standards of living are very, very similar to ours, and yet they conserve so much more energy than we do. So that needs to be at the forefront of what we do in order to mitigate this problem. I also say that as citizens, we must insist on having our leaders, you know, talk to your congressman and congresswoman to formulate a responsible energy policy. And in spite of, scientists who work on climate science having been, you know, put out there as the poster children for living off of government and wanting grants and not doing anything. They're actually doing a great deal that I think is going to be helpful to all global citizens. So I would also urge you as a citizen to support climate science. And I think I will end it there. And much of my work in the Antarctic has involved incredible logistics. You know, getting from point A to point B is very, very difficult. And the US Navy is absolutely amazing. They will take you anywhere. I don't know if there are any Air Force people around, but I've done so much fighting with the US Air Force. They want to see satellites of where you want to go, and has it snowed there recently? How do I know? You know, I haven't been there yet. So it's been more difficult to work with the Air Force because maybe they are more careful. They don't want to get you into trouble. The Navy just wants to know, when do you want to go? You know, let's go, let's go. And the Coast Guard has also been remarkable. They go and they take an icebreaker like the one pictured here and break ice in order for the American base, McMurdo Station, to be resupplied, although this was quite a little while ago, so this icebreaker is no longer in use, and we've been borrowing Russian icebreakers and Swedish icebreakers. It's quite a scandal. But these have been remarkable individuals in helping us to get into the field to do this work. So I better shut up now. Thank you very much for listening. Okay, I understand that if you have any questions, there is a camera in back there and they would like to tape what your question is. So raise your hand if you have a question and someone will bring a mic to you so that the camera will capture the question. So, any questions? Yes, sir.
Can you give a calibration between the temperature temperature rise?
Yeah.
Business as usual and the Paris Accord and so on. Calibrate that to the loss of ice.
To the loss of ice. What would happen to the ice? You know, it's a very difficult question to answer, and let me tell you why. As we look at the base of ice sheets, we are surprised by what we are finding. You know, it shouldn't have been surprising, but it is. And what is happening there is many of the continents where these ice sheets are, Antarctica being one and the island of Greenland being another, are underlain by bedrock that is primarily granitic in composition, very rich in uranium and other radioactive isotopes, which are decaying, and as they decay, they are producing heat. And that heat is not able to escape because there is a blanket right over it, you know, the ice sheet that's 2 or 3 kilometers thick. What that heat then does is to melt the bottom of that ice sheet. That's why the core I just showed you is only about 700,000 or 800,000 years at the very bottom. That's how old it is. But Antarctica has been glaciated for 35 million years. We don't have any ice that's 35 million years left because it melted away. Now, that melting is what is frightening, because what we are discovering is that beneath these ice sheets, there are massive lakes the size of the Great Lakes. There is a lake, for example, called Lake Vostok, first discovered by the Russians about 40 or 50 years ago, that is the size of Lake Ontario. And Lake Ontario is about 110 kilometers in length. So the behavior of those lakes is not well understood. But what it looks like, and I didn't bring the image with me, what it looks like is that they will periodically behave like a blister. They move from one area to another in a matter of just a few hours. Now, how those behave long-term is what's going to determine the fate of all of that ice. So we don't know the answer to that question just yet. But we thought, you know, the ice was really stable until we discovered that there are lakes underneath. In Antarctica, for example, the last time I looked, I think there were about 150 lakes discovered. And Vostok is the biggest one. That's about 110 kilometers long. The others are somewhat smaller. But nevertheless, a frightening prospect if they are on the move fairly rapidly. Another question over there.
So these climate models that they use to extrapolate forward,
yes.
Can they run them backward and see how well they reproduce the known past?
You know, that's the idea, that in order to have any faith in what the future predictions are, you need to convince us that if you had started in 1950 and wanted to predict what is happening today, that indeed you come very close to making that prediction or matching what has actually happened. And, you know, there are many, many climate models. Some of them are more successful than others, and some of them, you know, work for particular periods in time as we go back in history. But this prediction of, you know, going up to about a 3-degree change relative to today, I think that's pretty robust. It is based on, you know, understanding of the behavior of much of the material that's going into the atmosphere besides just CO2. Others are being considered. Hydrofluorocarbons, for example, and also the impact of methane, that's considered in the models.
Yeah. Thank you. Really appreciated the discussion here and kind of putting it in perspective. One question I have as we look at this, hard to dispute the facts, they are what they are. Where does population fit into that? I remember back in the 60s and 70s with population growth, and I think as population expands, you need more housing, energy, food, space for people. So all those carbon sinks of plants that were there that were helping that cycle start to get removed. Does that play in or
it does.
Give a sense there if you
it
could?
It does, and you know what I said about that is that, you know, I grew up in Kenya and Uganda in Africa in the 60s and 70s, when these were really, really poor countries. I make visits there now, and I can see that there's a lot more affluence. People that I knew when I was growing up were riding bicycles now have cars. And I've been going to China for the last 30 years and have been working with colleagues at various institutions there who in 1986 were riding bicycles. They have cars. Now they have cars. Terrible drivers, by the way. But I'm not kidding you. I'm not kidding you. I was in an accident in China just a few months ago with a colleague who used to ride a bicycle to work. So he's learned to drive at a much later time in life and so on. So that affluence is going to contribute to the problem we're describing because the carbon footprint of many people in developing countries has been really, really small. But it's going up. They are catching up with the lifestyles here, and that's going to compound the problem. Now, to your point about you know, population growth, in Africa today, there are about 1 billion people. 2050 is not that far off. You know how many Africans there are going to be in 2050? 2.5 billion. That is more than double the number of people on the continent today. You know, you watch the news and you see people who leave their homes and try to cross the Mediterranean to go into Europe. You know, the well-kept secret is that 5,000 people are dying per year drowning in the Mediterranean. You know, that would be, I calculated the other day, I think that would be like crashing 10 jumbo jets into the Mediterranean once a year. There would be a public outcry if 10 jumbo jets crashed into the Mediterranean a year. When the population goes to 2.5 billion, there'll be 20 or 30, perhaps, jumbo jets crashing into the Mediterranean, figuratively speaking, crashing into the Mediterranean per year. So what one hopes will happen is that, you know, a very well-recognized correlation by the United Nations is that when women become educated, there is an inverse correlation with how many children they're going to have. So the only way to really stop that massive growth in population in Asia and also in Africa is to educate the women. And, you know, I can tell you from my own family that my mother came from a family of 11. And my mother's generation had kids of 7, 5. And my generation, I have 1. My sister has 0. You know, so when you educate the masses, you begin to have a fighting chance of controlling population. And really, that's, I think, the trick to stopping some of that CO2 going forward. Yeah. And there was another question back there. Yep. Yep. And somebody tell me when to stop.
Yeah, I understand that particulate matter in the atmosphere can reflect sunlight. We've been working very hard to remove particulate matter from the atmosphere. Has that been working against this? And related to that...
You know, I didn't quite hear the beginning of your question.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I understand that particulate matter in the atmosphere can reflect sunlight.
Yes.
We've been working very hard to remove particulate matter, so are we working against ourselves? And related to that, it seems that reducing carbon dioxide politically, practically, is just very difficult. Do we have a backup plan?
The backup plan is build a very nice spaceship, and I'll come with you. But to your point about removing particulate matter, you know, I think that might depend on the scale of what you're talking about, because in big cities like Beijing or Shanghai or Tokyo or something like this, or even Los Angeles for that matter, particulate matter is very dangerous to human health. So when those particles are at eye level and are getting into my lungs, that's a serious problem. And their removal, therefore, is really, really important. But the ability to reflect sunlight is going to be most effective if they are light enough to rise to the stratosphere, you know, way up there, 10 kilometers up, then that helps us a great deal. But most of the particulate matter in cities due to combustion engines and so on doesn't quite get that high. It's going to be much closer to the surface. So I would be for removing it. Yeah. But, you know, when volcanoes erupt and they spew sulfur dioxide and aerosols of various kinds to very, very high altitudes, the effects are pretty pretty significant and they are measurable. When some of these volcanoes like Pinatubo erupted in the Philippines in 1991, you know, there was a noticeable drop in temperature for the couple of seasons or couple of years after that. So that was reflecting sunlight back into outer space. Are we done? Thank you very much.